$1 million. Somebody from China. Am I?
Hello, Ben.
Oh, I like that little intro.
How are we doing? Yeah, yeah. I thought you'd like that. That was for you.
Hey, nobody knows more about China than me, okay?
I like China. I like the Chinese people. I love the Mexican spirit. That was one of my favourites.
Nobody knows more about Mexico than me.
Nobody knows more Mexicans than I do, believe me. The food, the spirit, those hats. Beautiful. What a baby. Do you ever see that one on the campaign trail?
No.
Don't worry about that baby crying. It's a beautiful noise. I love babies. What a baby. I was like, taking a piss out of it. Like, what a baby.
Did you ever see a documentary with Trump and Ruby Wax about 10 or 15 years ago? Or maybe more, maybe 20 years ago.
No.
It's amazing how long Trump has been Trump. I mean, he's been this rich, famous baller for, like, just decades and decades and decades and decades. Like,
yeah.
And they were following him around. I reckon it was the mid-90s. And he had his massive jet, and he was surrounded by bodyguards and limos. You know, he's just been doing it so long. And, like, Ruby Wax was doing a fly on the wall with him. And she was, like, annoying him, because she's pretty annoying. And she was kind of getting on his nerves, and you know the chemistry wasn't good between them, and it's quite amusing. It was just really awkward.
Yeah, I've not seen that. I want to see that. Have you seen those all the adverts like throughout the years? Someone's made a compilation of all the different TV adverts and commercials he's done over the years, from like everything from Trump steaks to Trump wines. Trump, the game.
I think I've seen something, yeah.
It's amazing. What a brand.
I looked up, his name was mentioned, like before he ran for president, his name was mentioned in something like 120 like hip-hop rap songs.
Yeah.
Prior to 2015.
The Time, what it was one of Prince's sort of side projects, alter ego bands. Mm. And they had a song. There's a song called "Donald Trump Black Version,"
right?
Which is basically just about them being rich and going around in limos and killing it.
I'm
when you listen to it now, like in the 80s, you know, to a lot of black people and people in general, Trump was an icon. You know, like a thing to be.
Yeah. Prior to his presidency, like, nobody had any problems with him. He was just, you know, a business icon, just, you know, the American dream success icon.
Yep. Mm. Other than the general jealousy of eat the rich, nobody had any particular problems with him.
Nobody's calling him a sexist or a racist. Yeah,
exactly, yeah. All that label slinging.
I read his books as well. Like, it's surprising the amount of stuff he's done, like, just the amount of charity he's given to in his books, like the amount of money he's given away is just eye-watering amounts of money, you know, to the average person, just millions and millions and millions and millions and millions and millions, you know.
I know this. I know he doesn't take a wage at the minute, like, and that's not a lot anyway, you know, relative to what Trump earns elsewhere and what have you.
Mm.
So, I mean, that's not that impressive to me, per se, but...
Mm.
As a symbol, it's quite a thing, though, isn't it? I think all of his is it going to a veterans charity? It's going to some charity, all of the presidential, and that's I don't know. It's symbolically cool, I guess.
Yeah, I think so. There was a cool story. Did you ever hear the one? His limo broke down once, and some farm couple, kind of, I don't know. I don't know what they did. They helped him or something, or took him into his house while the limo got fixed or something like that. And he paid off their mortgage as a thank you.
Sorry?
He paid off their mortgage as a thank you.
What? I've never heard that. No. Oh, what a tale. I hope that's true.
Yeah.
That's class.
But anyway, how's your relationship with the Freemasons going?
Funny you should ask me that. I was just speaking to my mum before, and she said, you need to stop all this Googling. And she went, flat earth, Freemasons.
Who said that?
I think she might be right. My mum.
Oh, your mum. Yeah.
You need to stop all this Googling. Flat earth and Freemasons.
Well, she might have a point, but I love the way the wording she chose. You've got to stop all this Googling.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, no, it's probably not wrong.
To an extent. Yeah, yeah, it's balance, it's family and all this stuff. But I do get, I don't know, I'm quite obsessive with stuff, you know. I'll be on this for a while and then I'll move on to something else.
Yeah.
And you know what I'm like.
You know, it's kind of, for us, it's a form of entertainment as well, isn't it? Like, you know, a lot of people, they do other kinds of entertainment. They'll sit in front of the TV and watch a series back to back, or, you know, and so really, is it much different? You know, we're just sort of surfing the internet.
Yeah, I can't stand that, watching series. There's stuff going on in the world that I'm not supposed to know about, or people don't want me to know about, and that's exciting. I want to find out what that is.
I want
to find out what's going on.
Yeah,
there's
totally
always stuff to be learned that's of interest.
I think it's very easy to kind of, like, social media gets really hated on, doesn't it? I mean, like, it's very easy to criticize people who spend time on the internet, but it gets a real bad rap, doesn't it? But it's not necessarily that bad, you know?
Well, no, it's like, it's just one of those, it is a tool, isn't it? And it's completely how you use it, why you use it, what you do with it.
Yeah.
You know, as opposed to TV, which is a pure one-way street.
Yeah.
You know, you sit there and be hypnotized.
Yeah, totally.
Or not.
It grinds my gears when people say, you know, make these sweeping blanket statements about, oh, we spend too much time on our phones nowadays. People are spending too much time on social media. And I think, speak for yourself, you know, I'm doing all kinds of stuff on my phone. You know, I'm doing businessy stuff. I'm organizing events. I'm doing marketing. I'm doing emails. I'm doing invoicing. I'm doing banking. I'm doing all kinds of stuff. You know, who's to say, just because they ain't being productive, why should they be deciding, you know, what I should be doing?
Yep. It's no good for me, so it's no good for anybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a little bit more that the one size fits all thing. It's, you know, it applies to all sorts of areas of life, like the drugs thing about what's legal and illegal. You know, different things work for different people. You just have to let that go.
Hey, I've got a cool story. I might be going into business with a friend who produces hemp products like CBD oil and stuff.
Oh, sweet.
And we haven't hashed out the details yet. We're not at the state. We haven't actually done a deal yet, but we're going in that direction. And me and somebody, basically, I'm going to be more on the sort of marketing and sales kind of thing because that's more my realm of what I know about.
Yeah. CBD oil. Yeah. Specifically.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah, basically. I mean, I don't know that much about it, but I'm in the process of learning the ins and outs and the legalities and all that. But is it something you know much about?
Yeah, no, same. Just kind of surface area stuff. It reduces inflammation. It's good for all kinds of ailments and what have you. No, I don't know any secrets about it, but it's fascinating stuff.
Yeah,
it's good stuff. I mean, there's a shop in Lancaster where I'm at, where you can get CBD oil-infused coffees.
Really?
Yeah, they're cool.
And, like, I've never taken it, but does it make you feel different? What happens?
I don't think, because I smoke weed as well, obviously, which is CBD and THC. And it's the THC which gives you the high. And CBD oil supposedly doesn't do any of that, although I was convinced I could feel a little something. But then, upon reflection, that's probably just placebo because I was looking for it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
It was just nice and chilled, you know, like having a coffee. But
that's what people say. I think it makes you feel mellow. Like, it doesn't get you high, but it does. It does make you feel a bit mellow, I think.
That's pretty much how I felt. Yeah, not high, but at ease.
What I'm particularly having to learn about it is like what the laws are in terms of like whether you can make claims of health benefits or not, because I don't think you can claim that it will cure a certain thing. You've got to be careful with your wording. So I'm learning the ins and outs around that, because if we start marketing it and saying this cures, you know, XYZ, then, you know, we could find ourselves in hot water. But if we word it correctly, you know, it could be a good business.
Yeah, the place near me that does it, it's the Damn Good Coffee Shop, you know, damn as in Amsterdam.
Right.
And all the writing on the menu is done in, like, green chalk. You know, it's all It's all the implied stuff.
Is it frequented by people with dreadlocks and lip piercings?
Oh, hey, yeah, but you get old deers in there, and it's very it's surprisingly mixtured. It's really nice. Oh. Everyone knows what they're up to. It's all slightly hush hush, yet but obviously legal, and it's quite new. So
what's it called again?
Interesting. The Damn Good Coffee Shop.
Okay, I'll look that up. Because, like, all of a sudden, because I've now got a potential business interest in this kind of thing, I'm sort of suddenly interested in that the whole, you know, that world.
Yeah. I think, marketing-wise especially, I think they've got it down. So not that I know a lot of marketing, but I notice stuff. Like, they close at 4:20.
Right.
Little things like that.
I mean, I've heard that reference to 4:20, but what does it mean exactly? Like, why 4:20?
I don't know the origin of it. I'm sure I did and I've forgotten it. It's gone in one ear out the other.
Mm.
It's April 4th. I know it's a big celebration. Everybody smokes weed in Manchester out on the streets and the police can't really do anything because there's too many people. I don't know. It's just a stoner number. It's like the 666 of... you know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, right, okay. What have you been up to last...
I don't fully understand how 666 applies to Satanism, it just does.
Yeah.
It's like how 420 applies to stonerism. It's just, I don't know.
I want to tell you about this, I'm interviewing this guy and he did a documentary basically about ghosts and he's going to be on my podcast. I watched it last night and...
Wow.
I'm kind of... Cool. I mean, I'm open-minded, you know, I'm on the fence with that kind of thing, you know,
Yeah.
I'm open to anything, really. You know, I'm not going to say one way or the other. I don't know. I don't know how the universe works.
Exactly, yeah.
Man. What have you been up to?
All sorts. A lot of Googling.
if your mum's to be believed, then yeah.
It's been going a bit mad on YouTube. I've been fleshing out the other channel a lot more. And researching a lot of stuff. Supposed to dislike them? What do you mean to do that?
Why is the moon landing stuff got your attention? I watched a bit of it, not all of it.
I think I've known for ages ago. I think I'd sort of proven to myself that it didn't happen, but I just sort of put it in the back of my mind and thought, you know, why would it be a big deal anyway?
Mm.
And then recently I had Owen Benjamin going on about it on his live streams.
Mm.
And he brought up a lot of evidence I'd not seen before and stuff and reminded me of a lot of things I already knew. And I just got looking into it and I did like a 48-hour binge.
Mm.
And there's just so much more there than I initially knew even. Like, God, there's no way. There's no way anybody went to the moon. And it was all supposedly done in like a 10-year period, of which now we don't have the technology anymore. Have you seen that one? Have you ever seen Don Petit, the NASA astronaut? He's the guy who said, like a few years ago, I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we no longer have the technology to do that anymore. We destroyed the technology. Mm. And it's like, no. Just one thing I know about technology is that it gets more efficient with time, more affordable, better, you know?
Yeah.
And something as groundbreaking as, quote-unquote, Earth-confirming, lol, as the fucking moon landing, that's not the kind of technology that you would destroy or lose or record over, as some of them claimed happened.
It would be It would be good if he'd been a bit more clear about exactly what he meant, because it was a short statement, wasn't it? It was ambiguous what he meant.
Oh, he's saying he'd love to go to the moon and he would do it straight away. The problem is, it sounds quite clear to me. The problem is they no longer have the technology because they destroyed it. Oh, and he goes on to say, and it would be a painful process to build it back again.
Yeah.
Oh, it'd be painful. Oh, poor Don.
Yeah, I'm...
And then sorry, Ben, I'm not too chewed up with this stuff, but it's like a tapestry. of information. That's why it's not want to be. It's not something I can summarize in 5 minutes or give you the pointer. Do you know what I mean? Mm. It almost requires a bit of a self looking into it and just question your own beliefs and what have you.
Yeah,
but
totally.
The one I was going to say was Buzz Aldrin. Buzz Aldrin admitted recently a little girl called Zoe. Sounds ridiculous, but it happened. It's on record. This little girl called Zoe interviewed him and said, why has nobody been to the moon in such a long time? And Buzz Aldrin goes, no, that's not an 8-year-old's question. That's my question. The reason is because we didn't go. And if you want to know why something, if you want to keep something going, it's good to find out why it didn't happen in the first place. Basically what he said.
Mm.
And my eyebrows hit the roof.
Yeah. Wasn't it Buzz Aldrin that said something about aliens and UFOs as well?
Yeah, I think, a few years ago there was a thing of him talking about them terraforming Mars or something. Mm. In his Freemason ring.
Yeah.
It's all rather sneaky. He's the guy who punched the guy. Did you see the guy who went round? There's a bloke who tracked down every astronaut who claims to have walked on the moon. This guy's called Bart Sibrel. And he tracked down every one of them and said, I just want you to put your hand on this Bible and swear you walked on the moon. Put an end to the debate. Mm. You know, I'm filming it and what have you. And none of them do it. Some of them literally run.
Mm.
And Buzz Aldrin punches him in the face.
Yeah, I think I've seen that clip. I wouldn't put anything past the government, to be honest. I dread to think the stuff that goes on that we don't even know about. And so, even though I don't know either way what happens, I'm not one of those people who just dismisses conspiracy theories purely on the basis that they're a conspiracy. You know, like, far as I'm concerned, it's perfectly possible to me that they hoaxed it, you know, even though I don't know. And all the creepy dark shit that they're alleged to get up to, I can perfectly believe it, you know.
Yep, and I'll say for the record, I don't know, you know, either way. As a when my mum was saying to me before, like, you don't believe the Earth is flat, do you? And I laughed. I said, no, of course I don't. But I don't believe that it's round either. I'm a skeptic.
Mm.
I'm happy to talk about it and question it and see what's what. You know, like, I don't, quote unquote, seriously believe anything, really.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And one of them would be to be skeptical. But in terms of consensuses and what have you.
I think it takes quite a lot of intelligence to admit that you don't know what you don't know, because a lot of people just fall into the trap of, like, needing to have an answer, and they're like, you get those kind of smart ass kind of people that they just, like, they'll kind of pretend they know when they don't really know. They'll just pick a side and commit to it.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, do you really know?
Yeah, absolutely, man. I found myself doing that in different areas, like, over time. And rebelling against that in myself, and hopefully and seemingly becoming more independent thinking and less dogma clinging all the time. And it's frightening to begin with, you know, because you don't have any sort of conclusions, but it's the ultimate reassurance, is because it's honest.
Yeah, I think that's why a lot of people aren't comfortable with it, because it there's something more comforting about thinking that you understand the world that you live in, isn't there? And there's something more unsettling about thinking, actually, I don't know a lot of stuff. I'm not in control of a lot of stuff. Like, that, in a way, that kind of takes a bit of bravery to sort of take that viewpoint, doesn't it?
Yeah. It requires an element of faith, whether it's faith in the dogmas you've been conditioned with, that you're taught and believe, and I saw it on TV, or it's faith in just your own reasoning abilities and the fact that you can look beyond it, and, you know, the world isn't going to fall apart. There either is or isn't an answer at the other side, and you know, whether God aside, there's a faith element to life. Because without it, you'd know everything. And I don't think anyone does. I think that's...
I,
It's a big dream, sort of the goal, and I think that's one of the things that they'll try and project from secret societies in the top 33rd degree Freemasonry and what have you. They paint this illusion that they've acquired the knowledge and they've mastered the universe. And you look at some of the people up there, Jimmy Savile. He's just an evil snake.
Hey, while we're on the kind of conspiracy topic, like recently I was watching stuff people were accusing, like the satanic ritual stuff. And have you heard of the adrenochrome thing?
Yeah, I've been looking quite a lot at that recently.
Right, it's the idea that they it's all the stuff that Alex Jones is talking about on Rogan as well. You know, the reason they terrorize people and do ritual stuff is to get, for some reason, the adrenaline in the blood gives you some kind of high. And so the claim or the accusation is that, you know, these elite satanic ritual people, that's what they're doing. They terrorize people to get the high from the blood. And, it kind of ties in with the kind of Dracula vampire kind of legends as well, doesn't it? You know.
Yeah, it's Monsters Inc. is supposedly a complete metaphor of that very phenomena.
Yeah,
you know, it's the job of the monsters was to go and frighten the children and capture the screams.
Yeah,
and the screams were valuable to the elite.
It's fucking creepy.
Horrifyingly. That film by Pixar really does seem to be a metaphor for precisely that. The film is littered with, and this is a bit more esoteric, but stick with me. The film is littered with the football, the classic soccer ball, that black and white thing with the, what is it, pentagrams, however you say that shape.
Yeah.
But the way it is from the front is the same molecular structure as adrenochrome.
Really?
Yeah. The front on angle of a football, soccer ball, it's the molecular structure of an adrenochrome.
Really?
Yeah. And that's throughout the... Just footballs, soccer balls at random points throughout the film. It's a potentially really sick film. And you've seen Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
No, I haven't.
It's Hunter S. Thompson who originally wrote it, and Johnny Depp played him and went to stay with him for a few months while he was learning about him and all that. And there's a scene in that film where he takes adrenochrome, and I think that's the first time it was in a film, like a mainstream, popular film. If that stuff is as legit as it seems to be, that might be the most sick thing that I've heard of.
Yeah. And
you know what I mean?
I had a friend. She used to do
stuff of nightmares.
Yeah. And it's really creepy the way that so many different references kind of all tie in together and kind of support it in there, from all different angles. There's all these, bits of tiny little slithers and chunks of evidence dotted around all over the place that kind of point to that, isn't there?
The guy on Jimmy Fallon just recently, they're doing like a truth or false sort of dare truth game thing, and the guy said, "Recently, my neighbour was arrested by the FBI for being a cannibal," and Jimmy Fallon's like, "What?"
I saw that.
You saw that, yeah. Was that in New York or was that in LA? Because I believe it more. You're just normalising it, making it seem like a joke, and well, maybe in LA, but maybe not in New York. And I think it's false. Turns out it was true. But
I had a friend. She used to do like cleaning or babysitting or au pair stuff for like this rich family. And this is only a little anecdote that just stood out in my mind. And they were like a posh family. She'd look after the kids and take them to school and shit like that. Wait a second. You still there, Dean?
You all right? Yep.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, somebody was calling me on the internet. And one of the kids, he was a young kid, he was like 12 or something, and she was telling, posh kind of English upper class accent, and he was saying, oh yes, at the weekend, daddy had loads of friends round, and they all went into the forest, and I went with them, and they had this, It's like a test tube or something of red stuff, and we all had to drink it, right? yeah, I know. And I mean that was the extent of that story that she repeated back to me. But it just makes you think, doesn't it? Like, what the fuck?
Wow.
Yeah.
That's. I mean, whatever that is, that's some weird shit.
Yeah, like, even if it's, like, grapefruit juice, like, why? What are you doing? Like, what's going on? Why are you just stood in the woods drinking it, you know?
Out of a test tube,
Even if it's just a reenactment of something, you know, even if it's not blood, like, still, what the fuck are you reenacting?
Exactly. Why glorify what's the... That was like the thing with when Alex Jones busted Bohemian Grove, and people were like, "Oh, it's just a mock sacrifice, you know? They're only pretending to slaughter people. Oh, it's all fine then.
That's not weird.
Yeah, not weird at all. Those, the world leaders stood around in robes in front of a big burning effigy of an owl, pretending to sacrifice human beings. Oh, it's pretending. Oh, it's all good and normal.
Yeah, what's for breakfast? Yeah.
Yeah. How much are eggs? And it's the fact that it was secret as well, like, because it's obviously something that the world would want to know about if a lot of world leaders and bankers were meeting up for anything. It's something that people, and particularly if they're doing so in robes and burning big effigies of owls and singing weird hymns, let's hear about it.
And I think...
it's not like it's not newsworthy.
Oh, yeah, something's going on there.
If you look at some of the shit in the news, I mean, my God.
You know, media outlets, there's a defense order that they get from the government when they're ordered not to report on something. Have you heard about that?
I think they call it
a D order or something like that. And it's basically when the media is told for national security, supposedly they're not allowed to repeat a certain story. But I mean, as far as I've read, you know, they will use that mechanism to sort of suppress any inconvenient information.
Right. And that's why I'm more likely to trust an independent journalist or a YouTuber than... what's that thing I said a bit ago? I nailed it. I'm more likely to trust random wackos on YouTube than I am elitist wackos on the BBC. Because... Mm. It's people say, well, why would so and so on the internet be telling you the truth? Why would so and so in the mainstream media be telling you the truth? Mm. They've got a huge vested interest to lie.
Mm.
You know, some randomer picking bones and quizzing things on the internet is more likely to be on an honest venture than
someone
who works for the Beast. I would assume.
Yeah, exactly. Like, why is, like you say, like, why is central government more credible and more trustworthy and more honest than individuals?
I think the opposite. And again, it's not, I don't want to become, you know, like I was saying about some people who will just believe whatever's confirmed on the TV.
Mm.
Although I typically will... A good rule of thumb is to assume bullshit and work backwards on that mainstream media stuff.
Mm.
I don't want to become that opposite of, you know, the people who assume every conspiracy is bullshit and every mainstream official thing is true.
Yeah.
I don't want to become that cast opposite where I'm just like, you know,
everything
in the media is a lie and the moon's made out of cheese.
Mm. Yeah, I know what you mean. I don't think we're in danger of that, are we? Because we're self-critical enough and rational enough to sort of double check, you know, our thought process as we go along. But there is people on both ends of the spectrum, isn't there? There's, like you say, there's people that dismiss everything that's on the mainstream news and believe everything they see on YouTube, and then the opposite is true as well. But I don't think we fall into those categories.
People think I am, though. People have been concerned, and so. I just feel we need to slap that concern down. It's all fine.
Yeah, concern can be really annoying. I remember when I was into the free man on the land stuff and my family were concerned, but it's kind of like concern is kind of patronizing, isn't it? Like, I wouldn't mind if they just ask you, like, if they just ask you, like, what do you believe? Like, what's going on? Tell me. Like, you know, but just sort of projecting concern at you is just really irritating.
It's very crab in the bucket-y, isn't it? That starts to feel to me a bit. When it goes without speculation, you know, without a conversation, just you don't actually think, you don't seriously, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, those aren't arguments, are they? They're not.
No, it's fear projected, you know. It's someone you know and trust, seemingly believes something that's strongly against what you do, or at least questioning something that you try. It's an instant mirror, and you know it's unsettling. It can be uncomfortable, but you know it should be that. This is life. This is growth. We have to question and each other and ourselves and that, and this, you know, there are growing pains. Don't shoot the messenger, he says in a bulletproof vest.
I suddenly thought of this guy that emailed me a while back. You know, I think you've heard me talk about Winston Stratford times. He was like one of the kingpins of the free man on the land, sovereign citizen, tax protester movement.
Right.
He's just about to go to prison because for not filing taxes and for writing fake financial instruments, right?
Which is happening now.
Yeah, that was all part of his big theory. Like, you know, the government issues money and the central bank money is just promissory notes. So if they can do it, why can't we, kind of thing? And he's finally been done and busted for it.
Right.
And I got this email from this guy and he was saying, oh, Ben, I saw your stuff about the free man of the land. I wonder, can you explain to me how to write a bond? And I was like, no, because it doesn't work and it's all bullshit and, you know, and all that crap doesn't work. So don't bother. You just get yourself in trouble. And he got shitty with me. He was like, yeah, but Winston Strout. And I was like, Winston Strout's literally got convicted, you know, a few days ago or whatever it was at the time. And this guy's arguing with me. And he's like, right, fine, if you don't want to tell me, you know. Sort of bad. And I'm like, what is the matter with you? This guy that you're, so say, learning from just got done. He wasn't able to make it work successfully himself.
Right. And so you're trying to keep him out of trouble by...
Yeah.
Right, by not telling him how to...
The guy's arguing with me.
Come out the bond.
I don't know.
Faith over evidence, eh?
I don't know why that jumped to mind, but it was just in terms of, like, how to protect someone, you know. Like, you got to explain... If someone's doing something wrong that's going to get themselves in trouble, you got to explain your thought process of why it's wrong. It doesn't help just to tell them you're concerned about them. It's like, I explained to the guy, it doesn't work for this reason, that reason, and that reason. I think that's why it made me think of it.
Yes. Well, you see, people sadly won't listen to evidence. You have to wait. They'll have to wait for it to come out in the papers.
Yeah.
Authority over evidence. You know, that is the general, seems to be the general stem of where beliefs come from in general, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's authority. Like, evidence is way second place to authority.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
It's scary and exciting, you know, it's always got the other side of the coin as well. It's not doom and gloom, in some ways it is empowering because it, I don't know, inspires me to go searching when I think of that.
Yeah. Isn't it weird, like, when it comes to, like, helping people or having an impact or helping the world, it's quite an art, isn't it? Like, you've got to meet people halfway a little bit because... If you just give them the hard facts, they're not going to listen. They're not going to be interested. They're going to get bored and distracted and no one's going to listen. But, like, I don't know, if you find a way to present information that sort of meets people a bit more where they're at, you've got more chance of actually getting the message across, haven't you?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, it's a bit of a dance, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And in a way... When I think of, like, Russell Brand, like, obviously he's very popular and very famous, and I don't, you know, the stuff he says I don't necessarily agree with, but he's speaking at the place where more people are, isn't he? And, you know, and that's why he's getting more attention. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think so. He's very, he's very tolerant, I think is a good word for Russell Brand. Do you know what I mean? Like, even against ideologies, you would think he would be against, you know, Peterson, you know, he's had Peterson on and Sam Harris and what have you.
Mm.
And he's, yeah, I think he's a good character. I think he's a good interviewer.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's
a funny
great.
Guy.
He's great in many ways. He's a little bit misguided in some ways, but he's great in many ways.
Yeah, I think he's toned it down a bit on the leftism.
Yeah, he has a bit. He's got a bit more spiritual and a bit more wise, hasn't he, lately? I prefer his latest sort of reinvention of himself. Like, when he was just hanging out with single mums and telling them that nothing was their fault and, you know, society's against them, like, that was kind of irritating me a bit because he was going, he was sort of pandering to, you know, the welfare class. Of people, yeah, basically, yeah, he was just sort of trying to impress single mums, wasn't he? But he's got a bit more now. He's spitting more.
That was his whole act, wasn't it? It was a single mum act. Target market.
It's not your fault that you're poor. It's the banker's fault. You know, it's like, oh man, fuck off. But yeah, I prefer his latest stuff. It's more wise and helpful.
Yeah, it seems to have. Yeah, I don't know. Matured. He's got kids now, hasn't he?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, they say that helps.
Yeah, they do, don't they?
Yeah, literally all of them.
I'm Facebook friends.
You'll understand one day.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know what Bill Burr said about it. He's like, I do understand. Was it Bill Burr or someone else? He's like, it's just like having a dog, but more responsibility.
He's good, isn't he?
Mm. Yeah, it's hilarious.
On that topic, what's going on with the comedy?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting back on it. Summer, we're going to do some gong shows, and I don't know why it just sounded nice in my mind. Summer, I'll do it in summer. Maybe I'm not artificially delaying it. I could probably do something sooner, especially gong shows. You know, they're only 5 minute shows.
Right.
Just laziness, I think.
Fair enough.
I've not fleshed out a full set yet, but I've got enough bits and pointers and things. I would, you know, for 5 minutes, I could probably have a bash.
What kind of themes? Like, is it like, are you doing sort of society, political kind of stuff or not?
Yeah, a bit. Again, it's that, like we were saying before, it's the dance, isn't it? There's a bit, the meet them halfway, there's the meet them fully there, and then there's the wave at them from across the shore and freak them out a bit. It usually just open with something that's irrefutable, that's kind of like universal. Like, hopefully not too corny. Like, I used to have this thing about, my mum wanted kids and my dad wanted sex. Here I am, trying to figure it out and put the rest, something like that. You know, something that's sort of a bit under, that everyone can kind of go, oh, yeah.
Oh, I see. So is it better to build rapport first and then challenge that rapport a little bit?
I think so. And again, I'm no expert, but the way I find it works best, or is better for me. Yeah, start off on the same page and get like, oh, yeah, these guys. And then, whap!
Right.
Just freak them out a bit, and then they'll be ideally 70% of them that'll go, oh fuck yes, and then the 30% of them that'll go, oh, did he really think? Did he actually believe?
Yeah, I see.
That's when it's perfect.
Yeah, I guess if you're saying stuff where everybody in the room agrees with you, you're not really pushing any boundaries, are you? And then but then, you know, if you do it where everyone disagrees with you, you've gone too far. But somewhere in the middle is probably...
Yeah. Yeah, you want laughs and gasps simultaneously.
Right, that's interesting. I see.
Well, that's what I want.
Yeah. There must be a formula to it. Like, you're further ahead on that topic than I am. But just from an outsider, there must be a formula to comedy. There must be.
I think there's a lot. Like, people like to try and boil it down to like a a simple formula. Like one of the classics is the element of surprise. I'm sure you've heard people talk about that, comedians talk about that.
Mm.
But it's not, I mean, there's more to it than the element of surprise. Otherwise, I could just go around all day in a mask and just sneaking up on people. I mean, the greatest comedian of all time. I don't know. It's very much like life. It's the dance between what you know and don't know and finding things you don't expect, where you least expected. It's a weird, weird little art form.
Yeah, isn't it? I mean, I imagine it's
kind of like magic.
Yeah, like magic and like music as well, because we're both musicians. And, you know, to an extent, you can practice scales and chords and stuff, but then there's that element that you can't really learn. It's just you've either got it or you don't, isn't it?
Yeah, to some extent, I think, yeah. And there's certain things, aspects of it that can be, you know, trained and work, delivery and confidence and stuff like that. But the mind that's going to sink around corners, just, it seems to be a bit more innate than learned, at least in my experience.
Yeah, that seems fair. So, so look, as the music, what are you working on then? What's the next 3 months?
Again, I've been immersed in all this Googling. It's, my album's still on the back shelf. I'm still working on language in practice, and Leroy's waiting for me to go around and finish those recordings. I've got some good songs on it, Ben.
Wait a second, is that a new album?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not finished yet. I've got the International Man of Misery. You know, like the International Man of Mystery, Austin Powers.
Mm.
It's like a remix of the Austin Powers beat. And the rap is all about me going around this party trying to pull girls from different continents all over the world, and they all fail. And it's the International Man of Misery, so it's pretty cool. You'll have to hear it. It's hard to describe, but it's fun.
Are you also recording music videos for all this, like you always used to do in the past?
I'm going to be doing, yeah. I want two videos at least, minimum. It's going to be about eight tracks, so probably more of a big EP than an album. And, I'd like to get two videos out of it, two lead singles.
And then, will you perform it?
Yeah. I've got, I'm doing Eden Festival in June with the Melodrome stage. They've been kind enough to have me back.
Okay. Eden, what's it called?
Eden. It's in Lower Scotland.
Is it? Oh, right.
I know.
Okay.
Yeah, it's at the bottom of Scotland. I'm going to get a lot of pub gigs on the run up to that, just to get brushed up I want new songs as well. I don't want to just turn up and do all the stuff I did last year with the band, but without the band. I want some new stuff.
From your point of view, what's the best paid gigs? Like, what's the easiest money for you?
Because in general, it's not what I do or have done yet, but the best paid money is cover bands.
Right.
Just, yeah.
No, but I mean more, like, what's viable for you?
Probably the pub gigs.
Mm.
We've done a few weddings when we were in Divide and Conquer. Mm. And the weddings and New Year's Eve, if you could get a New Year's Eve gig, they're great.
Mm.
Like, really, like, stupidly good.
Mm.
Pub gigs are good, but I mean, what I find as a solo artist doing a pub gig, I'll get like a little bit less than I would as a band, but as the band, we split between eight of us. Yeah, on my own, it's all for me.
Yeah, that's always the way, isn't it? I remember when I used to gig, I was in...
It's much better monetarily, 100%.
Yeah, I was in 800%. About... I think I was probably in like five or six different bands, and most of them I was doing covers, and then the final band that I was in, we were doing our own original music. And so I'm glad I did that, because that kind of gave me the creative satisfaction of having done an original band, you know. But
cool. I didn't know you'd done that.
Yeah.
An original band.
Yeah, it was called El Guapo. We were pretty influenced by Chili Peppers, Rage Against the Machine. We were kind of hard funk rock kind of stuff. Very,
cool.
Very edgy, pretty sexy, you know.
Yeah, man. Where did that go?
To be honest, I got fed up with it. I grew out of it. I was like, I've had enough of this. I don't want to be a guitarist. Like, the novelty wore off. I was just fucking fed up with carrying amps and speakers and driving around in the middle of the night and never pulling as many girls as I thought I deserved to. And you know,
Do you enjoy the gigs?
Well, yeah. I mean, when I was on stage, I enjoyed it, but it just seemed like so much work and preparation and rehearsal in order just to have that 1 hour where you're up there, you know, having fun. Mm. I just got to the point where I thought, this ain't worth it, you know. It's like so much. I'm not getting enough out of it. But the reason I mentioned it is like the easiest money I used to get. We had a Chili Peppers tribute band called the Red Hot Silly Feckers. We had a function band as well, which was like weddings and stuff. That was called Funky Dory. And so that, yeah, it's like you said, if you're playing covers, it's easier, quick cash in the, you know, in the short term.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, and it's that stands to reason. I mean, if you get put in on a party, if you're getting married, if you, you know, you're going to look for a cover band of songs that you like, rather than take a chance on some local dreadlocks. Well, that's why we were lucky, because the weddings and stuff that we did do, it was the people who had already seen us, you know, in the past, obviously, and liked us. And that was a nice thing.
Yeah, that's cool. So you were playing your own music at a wedding?
Yeah.
That's a deal.
Yeah, that was really nice. That was, one of my favourite things.
Yeah.
And the New Year's Eve. When we got the New Year's Eve gigs and stuff, that was quite an honour. Because, I mean, New Year's Eve is the most mainstream night, I think, that's going, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool. If you could be a party band and you're doing your own stuff and you're playing at like at cool occasions, then that's totally ideal.
Yeah, I miss it. I do miss it.
Yeah.
Not in a I want you back way, but in a I like to reminisce. And, Oh god, it was good fun.
So Eden's going to be solo, is it, as opposed to band?
Yeah. It's going to be weird. I'm playing at the same stage and the same thing that I did last Eden Festival with the band. So like I say, I definitely don't want to just be doing all the same songs minus the band, because that'll be shit.
Yeah.
I'm going to do some stand-up. I don't know. Some spoken word, I'll call it at this point. I'm going to mix it up. Bits of spoken word, bits of poetry, bits of acoustic, satirical songs, pissing on the news and stuff.
Yeah, that's cool. That'd be nice just to weave it in and out of music, so that like it's not specifically a stand-up comedy set, but it's like you're weaving it into a music set.
Yeah, it's going to be a bit of a variety show. I've got two 20-minute slots to do.
And that kind of makes things easier as well, doesn't it? Because, like, I don't know, if you're sort of being funny and you run out of something to say, you can just move on to the next song, can't you? It gives you a safety net as well.
Yeah. I'll have a guitar around my neck at all points. So if I ramble off into, you know, nowhere,
I remember seeing, I've never really watched a great deal of live music, but this one time I saw this guy called Bert Miller and the Animal Folk, and he was really, really funny. Really funny. His personality pretty much was a cross between Ace Ventura, Jim Carrey, and Russell Brand. He was kind of, I think he'd assimilated both of those characters into his own character.
Yeah, what a character.
Yeah, he was a kind of over the top, like ultra eccentric and really funny guy. And all his songs were about animals, which actually makes me think that he probably inherited that from watching Ace Ventura movies. But every single song was about saving animals.
What?
Yeah, I'll send you some links. He's really funny.
Yeah, I'll check it out. I'm just thinking, like, what, you know, different strokes, different folks and that, but where's that come from? Like, it's one thing, the dedication to being a band, like we said, to rehearse, to write, to and all that, but for it to be centered around, I mean, maybe that's his thing. Perhaps he's just all satirical and I'm just totally not getting it. Or maybe he's like an animal rights dude or something. I don't.
I'll send you it. It's pretty cool. It was pretty cool. I mean,
Yeah.
I mean, I left thinking, oh God, I wish I was as funny as him. You know, it kind of left me like that.
Yeah. Anyway, I'll give him a watch.
All right. Well, I don't know if you've got anything else on your mind. I've got to interview this ghost hunter in a minute.
Oh, is that at 4?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah. There's nothing burning.
Good to know.
No, I've drawn a blank, Ben. I can't think of anything I need to tell you.
All right.
I'll ask you.
Okay, well...
Hey, could you send me the documentary that this ghost person made? Because I want to watch that and then see what I'll check out the podcast.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
All right. Later, right, Dean. Cheers. By the way, one more thing.
Go on.
There was a guy in Wetherspoons who'd listened to our podcast and he was saying, I listened to the Dean and Marroni podcast.
Oh, no way. Cool.
Yeah.
What was his verdict?
Well, his verdict, he was enjoying
his... Stop talking to that Dean Maroney guy.
No, he liked it. He was enjoying his £4.99 traditional English breakfast and his and his free refill coffee. And he loved our episode.
Ah, nice.
Yeah.
Good to know.
All right.
Onwards, Ben.
Later. Cheers.
Take care, man. Bye. See ya.